And you'd like me to explain that? When you're in the sword, my priest, that's going to be in the convocation. When you talk about Paul's infirmities, it's to be explained and broke down among people that has grown up the way they won't stumble at an apostle's weaknesses. Because we don't like to think of men like Paul having weaknesses. And if I stand here and break that down publicly, then I'm going to break down the confidence that somebody would have in the scripture. And I'd be doing the audience no harm. Because I would have to expose his human part. And some people don't believe that all of a man is divine. But a man has both human and divine. He has his defects and his perfection mark. And Paul was a man like every other apostle, acknowledging that something bound me. Now, Brother Funford just said that was for women, but it was not with women. The man never had any feelings, any relation. He was a eunuch. He was different to Peter. Now, Peter was a married man. Paul's weakness was, he was such a revelator. He was a man that could stand up and visualize and bring more out of one voice of the prophets than any other apostles. That's what he called himself, the chief. And he said, concerning the revelations that was given to me, I was about to be exalted above measure, which means I was about to get beside myself. See, I was boasting too much about Paul. And you know, I heard some apostles, everything you say, I did. But Paul was one of those kind of preachers. So one book in Corinthians said, Paul used I more than what? Some chapter of Corinthians, he used I 10 times more than he did twice. Well, what if this was given to me, this was my weakness. And he said, I needed to overcome it, and I could suffer the devil 3 times about it. And he said, you know what my answer was? Within me. What was my answer? My grace. And my strength. My strength is already in you. It's made perfect when you're weak. That's just another way of saying, you have to shut yourself and stop thinking about yourself. And for the moment, they don't feel that for the big thing. My God Almighty is the big tank. He's the distributor. They don't feel that from a oil truck. They don't feel that from the truck. But they feel that they take it from the big tank, from the refinery, then the big tank. Then it gets smaller and smaller. The truck. Then the truck, the station. The station, the vessel. The vessel, the lamp. Well, you look like a monkey trying to fill a lamp from a big tank. They say, you can open up this barrel where there's $10,000 to get 2 quarts. The man will tell you that, we don't set lamp. Well, I'd waste 10 gallons trying to shut this barrel on.
All right. Yes, sir.
So that can emulate all of you talking about I'm going direct to Jesus and get filled. Well, that's the big tank.
Right.
He don't open the big bath.
All right.
No, sir.
Just to fill the lamp.
No, sir.
If everybody else explain it any different. I guarantee you don't hear nobody else explain it. That's one scripture that just don't try to explain. They're talking about the Holy Ghost as oil. But you never see one go into details talking about what's the vessels. Who's the lamps?
Amen.
You don't learn that in school. That's a divine revelation. Later time we get run down, get despondent, regardless of how you run me down, how you muddy me. We don't get on about that old can and get muddy. Once in a while they say, you're just trying to can. Just trying to can. So we're going to run it down. We're going to run it down, but they're trying to can. All right. The minute the vessel gets there, the lamp starts burning.
All right.
I pray that I made that thing. All right. Your name. I don't think anyone can get the Holy Ghost and lose it. I think you can get the Holy Ghost and it lose you.
All right.
The Holy Ghost is such a fast man until you can't lose it. If y'all only keep up, it stays ahead.
Yes, sir.
And when we're speaking of losing it, we're talking about life journey. As we travel, can we lose it? No, you can't lose it. Here's what happened in Isaiah 63, 10, if you please.
Isaiah 63,
10? But certainly, you know, I'm going to stop over myself, so why are these questions? They might come up one after a while, man. They're taking back now. The people that had it, the people that it was controlling and guiding, the people that it was comforting and teaching, they got to a place they wouldn't hear. They rebelled against it. And they made it become to be vexed with them. And
therefore, he was
trying
to be their enemy.
They didn't lose it. But that thing that used to fight for them turned around and started fighting against them. And it fought against them. So they didn't lose it, but it lost them. The thing that was fighting to make the way pain is now fighting to confuse.
All right. Amen.
The devil keep me confused. It might not be the devil. It could be the Holy Ghost. When you get the devil fighting, you got somebody fighting that can be stopped. When you get the Holy Ghost fighting against you, you got somebody fighting that can't stop. That's why David got to that place and he said, oh Lord, take not thine Holy Spirit from me. I've been grieving it. I've been vexing it. But you watch me. Don't you let this thing leave me.
All right.
So you cannot have it and lose it. You can have it and it lose you.
All right. All
right. Leave you to any spirit that might come along looking for you.
All right.
And so many spirits come up and ask the Lord, can I have it? You don't believe in it. Then they come up and ask the Lord, say, I'd like to have him. I'd like to have him. And the Lord said, what you going to do with him? Say, I'd like to do this with him. And another one, the Lord said, I don't want that kind of spirit to take him. And another spirit come up and say, I'd like to have him. Say, give him to me, since you don't want him anymore. And the Lord said, what you going to do with him? And he said, I'd like to do such and such a thing with him. And the Lord was trying to get to the place where he said, one of those spirits, go get him. And make him think he's right. But lead him to destruction. Now you listen to the Bible talk. In the book of Kings,
22nd
chapter.
And verse 20.
And verse 20.
And
Lord
said,
we're going to get into that, ain't we? All right.
Who
Wait a minute, let them find it.
Well, the people that's on the radio that's listening, that's what they're doing here. They should have been reading the Bible, and somebody was looking in Genesis for things, and in Revelation for things, so... All right, it says, and the Lord said, the Lord was sitting down thinking, he said, who shall persuade Ahab?
That he may go up and fall
and bring
up Gilead.
I want him to go up and think that I'm going to be with him and deliver him as I has all other times. But I want a spirit to deceive him. One spirit came up and said, I'll do this.
And
another came up, that's what I was just saying. Another came up and said, I'll do this.
And
there eventually came both the spirit and stood up before the Almighty.
And said, I will persuade him.
And told the Almighty, said, I will persuade him.
And the Lord said unto him, wherewith?
And the Lord said to that spirit, said, how are you going to do it?
And he said,
and that spirit said to the Lord,
I will go forth. And I will be a lion spirit in the mouth of all his prophets.
Everywhere he believed in his prophets. Uh-huh. And I don't want to get in his mouth. But I get in the mouth of the one that he believed in.
Yes, sir.
And I'll be a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets.
Yes, sir. And he said, thou shalt persuade him.
The Lord said, thou shalt persuade him.
And the Baal also.
And the Baal also.
Go forth and do
it. Go ahead and do it.
Now therefore.
Behold.
The Lord
has
put a lying spirit.
No, the Lord don't give no lying spirit. The devil gives lying spirit.
And the mouth of all these
dark prophets. These
preachers
can't preach the
truth.
And the Lord has spoken evil concerning thee. So now, they don't lose it. It loses them. Now that goes right on to the New Testament. If you want to check that, you can even run that to 2 Thessalonians 2:9. It goes right on through. It don't just stop in the Old Testament. It just have a beginning there.
2:9.
Say.
And then shall that wicked be revealed.
The wicked is in a person that he's been covering up and not acknowledging.
Uh-huh.
When it comes to these leaders, he won't give himself to the Lord.
Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth
and
shall destroy with the brightness of his coming.
And.
Even him.
Even him.
Is after the working of faith.
Now, the Apostle Paul saw that same spirit coming. And he said, the one that's coming is after the working of Satan.
With all power.
And he's got some power. Haven't they been here with all power?
And
signs? He will be here with power enough to persuade people to sell him a $25 holy bed.
All right.
That's power.
And signs?
And they can wear signs.
And
everything it does is a lying
wonder.
With all deceivableness of unrighteousness.
And them that perish.
And it can't fool nobody but them that
perish.
That
die.
Because they sat here and listened to me preach time after time. And they heard it, but they never received the love of the truth. That they might be saved.
And for this
cause.
Thou shalt send them strong delusions. That they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth.
Now somebody talking about the death, the Lord won't read you wrong. You rebel and reject his word. He declared in Psalms 125:5, he is there for such as turn aside unto their evil ways. The Lord shall lead them forth with the weapons of iniquity. They say what?
Turn aside unto their crooked ways.
Yes.
The Lord shall lead them forth with the weapons of iniquity.
Well, you're talking about Jesus will never lead you wrong. I should not give that person that answer, depending on where you're standing.
Amen.
Jesus knew that the Almighty would lead wrong. He would lead according to the dictation of your own heart.
Amen.
And he said, where do you put it? So ask and said, lead us not. In the temptation. All right. All right, next one, sister.
Explain Revelation
10. Revelation 10:1. How many more you have this morning? Two more. All right. About two more. You must be getting some new ones.
Revelation 10 and 1.
Sorry.
And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven.
And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven.
Clothed with a cloud. And a rainbow was upon his head. And his face was as it was the sun. And his feet as full as the fire.
Did you give any particular verse there? Now, I could just preach from now until you see that angel, because the way it talks, I don't need to tell you who that is. And I pray that you are not associating this angel with Gabriel, that your preacher have preached to you, says, plant 1 foot upon the sea and have no land. Right. This is not Gabriel. No. And I go over it again, and let's see this.
And I saw another mighty angel.
Now, just listen, and you will see. Do I have to explain this? Now, if this question, when he said, explain this, does this mean you want me to talk on it? Well, that, when you talk about angels like this, you could be talking about him until you run out of time. But all you need to know is who. All right?
And I saw another mighty angel.
Not just an ordinary angel, but Maria. He is an angel which is above all angels.
Come down from heaven. Clothed with a cloud. And a rainbow was upon his head.
Even the scriptures itself explain this. I heard so many scriptures talking about, behold, he comes. The cloud. You've heard me preach so often times. When a chain told, they had a rainbow around his shoulder.
And
the
rainbow was upon his head.
Just give me the first
verse,
and we're
going
to have to move.
His face was as
it
were the sun,
and his feet as full as the fire. When you get a man's face outshining the sun, and you can't gaze into the noonday sun,
all right.
It's going to blind you.
All right.
And when you get a man that's so powerful until his face shines like the sun, you don't need to ask me who this is. I could stand here and call you 342 different common names. Still talking about that one angel.
All right.
And I could just say that on that one verse and that one angel and talk to the dead getter. And I believe just if I could talk long enough and find favor with that angel, that eventually he would anoint it with enough power.
All right.
But the dead couldn't stay in his life. This was tried one time. They had this angel hanging. They hung him. Angel only means messenger. And this is the messenger of God. This is God's man, God's way of expressing himself to the world. While they had this angel hanging there, dying, and they was burning on him, saying, you saved yourself, save others. You saved others, save yourself. They couldn't harp on him too long until the earth got nervous and started shaking. And it shook until the breeze opened. And it shook until dead got him.
Yes, sir.
And I believe I could hold a direct contact with him.
Yes, sir.
We just talked about that one. The dead will appear.
Yes, sir.
You can't bring his person. Now, you can bring his spirit. Because the spirit come in a condensed form. Amen.
Right.
But when you start bringing his person back to the ground, anytime you get his person back,
All right.
To the ground, both go to hell.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I don't want him to come right now. I heard somebody saying in Adam's tents over in Arizona that he saw him in his body walking under their tent. But any time this supernatural being walks, come in person. I ain't talking about the Holy Ghost. We know his spirit is here forcefully. That it can work signs and wonders. Yes, his name. Without a lot of our problems. But if I could drive this person, not his spirit, and he's saying, yeah, then his body, you could look up for the dead to come.
All right.
Well, they'd get up out of the graves around the river. And come to me. Now, this is the angel that made him. This is the one that angels bow to. All right. Let's see what he says. I'm thinking my reader's going to sleep. I don't know, man. I'm going to this one. I'm going to go with it. All right, let's see what he says. That's a kind of a crossway question, but I think it would. I don't think it would, a person would have to be right for me to say that he have a clean mouth for me to say that he told the truth. I don't think that I would condemn the truth because of a hellish attribution. Amen. Usually when a person asks a question like this, I heard that a lot of times, even growing up, when that's usually talking about preaching. Well, the preacher has a hellish mouth. Should you listen to him preach? I don't think that I follow, but I certainly think that anybody tells the truth, regardless of if you're an atheist. I say one time you told the truth. Well, you can't ever deny the truth anyway. All right, next. You have to go through. This would be a judgment. And she has to go head naked to be a queen. Anything that's going to strip her publicly and cause her shame, sure. Then I wouldn't want to be a queen, or queen, or prince. There's always room for good qualified people.